validating human existence. This is a concept that is found in the Hindu traditions, and it's called purushartha. And in Purush doesn't mean man as in Hindi. In the Sanskrit traditions, it means a conscious being. So how does a conscious being make his life meaningful? And it's a question that everybody has been asking. And it's a question that even Indra, the king of the gods, wanted to ask. And we are told that Indra was the king of the gods. He lived in this fabulous place called paradise, which was filled with all the wonderful things in the world. But he was feeling invalidated. So he called his architect, Vishwakarma, and said, build me a palace that is worthy of my glory. And when Vishwakarma built the palace and Indra saw it, he said, it's very good, but it is not good enough. Build me a grander palace. And so Vishwakarma built a grander palace and a palace after that and a palace after that, bigger and bigger palaces, but none could satisfy Indra because he would always say, it is not worthy of my magnificence. It's not good enough. Finally, Vishwakarma didn't know what to do. He prayed to the higher gods, and finally Vishnu comes to Indra in the form of a boy and says, you know what? Your palace is wonderful. It is indeed grand, but it is not as grand as the palace of the Indra who came before you. And Indra says, what do you mean who came before me? And the child, Vishnu, laughed and said, did you think you were the only one, Indra? There are many Indras in the world. There were Indras before you. There were Indras after you. There are Indras right now in different realms. In fact, there are as many Indras as there are grains of sand in a beach. This is the number of Indras that you have. And suddenly, Indra was presented with a denominator of infinity. He suddenly realized he is not unique. He's not special. He's one of infinity. And he felt an experience of nothingness. He doesn't matter. No matter how grand the palace he's going to build, someone has built it before. Someone has been better than him, someone has been bigger than him, or someone will be bigger than him in the future, and he will be forgotten. This way of thinking is a typically Indian way of thinking. It is found in the Buddhist traditions. It is found in the Jain traditions. It is found in the Hindu traditions, where you are constantly told that every individual is part of a canvas of infinity. When the denominator of your life is infinity, your value becomes zero no matter what you do. And that can be very invalidating. And therefore, the sages of India, the rishis, the jinnas, the buddhas, the sages, they wondered, how do you create value? How do you make your life meaningful? What is purushartha? How do I make my life meaningful? And they found their answers in nature. All answers were in nature. And the Indian method was darshan. Look in order to gain insight, because all answers are found in nature. And they found that nature was revealing things only if you observe it carefully. And they observed that nature is made of living things and non-living things. The non-living things, ajiva, which has no life, and living things which have life. And they said, who seeks meaning, the living or the non-living? Who seeks value? Who seeks anything? Do non-living things seek? Do they have hunger? And the one big realization that came is the elements, the pancha mahabhuta, the non-living things, whether it's fire or water, they don't seek anything. Even fire, once the fuel runs out, doesn't go running after fuel. The clouds move, but they're not running after something. The sky is not seeking anything. The water is not seeking. It's flowing, it's moving, but it's not seeking. It's not consuming anything. It doesn't seem to value anything. Very unlike a plant that values the sun and looks out for the sun and seeks the sun. It is seeking food. And for the plant, the sun becomes valuable. The earth becomes valuable. The wind becomes valuable. So value is attributed to the elements through the hunger of the plants. If plants did not exist, elements would just have no value. Suddenly, the sun has become precious. There's competition between plants for sunlight. There's competition between plants for water. Water has become precious. Sunlight has become precious. It is the hunger of the living organism that creates value in the other. Vanaspati, the plants give value to elements. What gives value to plants? The animals that feed on the plants. Because now the plant is valuable, the leaves are valuable, the fruits are valuable, the flowers are valuable. I want to consume it because when I consume it, I nourish myself. I take care of my metabolic processes, I stay alive. If I don't eat, I will die. Living organisms are afraid of death. And therefore they want food. And because they want food, they seek value. And how do animals become valuable? They become valuable because other animals eat them. And therefore the food chain is established. The animal eats the animal eats the plant eats the elements. There's consumption happening all the time. Bhog. Bhog is consumption. The consumer is bhogi. As long as there's hunger, there is consumption. As long as there's consumption, something else is getting value. That which is consumed, the commodity, the bhog. And we realize life is all about, when you look at nature, you realize everything is being consumed. Otherwise, a non-living planet is a place where no consumption takes place. There is no hunger. There is no value. Nobody is being given value. So I am valuable when someone consumes me. Humans consume everything. We consume the elements, we consume the plants, we just consume and consume and consume and consume. We are giving value to the world around us. Plants are valuable to us. Animals are valuable to us. Elements are valuable to us. We derive energy from everything with our technology. But the question is, who eats humans? Who eats you and me? Who consumes us? Because if nobody consumes me, I have no value. But I don't want someone to consume me the way an animal consumes an animal. I don't want to be consumed. I don't want to be eaten. I want to be give value but stay alive. A plant is stripped of its leaf when it gives value. I don't want to die like a deer being consumed by a tiger. So what do I do? How do I create value? And I learn from the plants and I realize, hey, can I create fruits and flowers that can be consumed without me dying? Therefore, I create goods and services. That's why humans create goods and services. You don't have to eat me. Yeah, I have something, I've cooked food for you. I provide you various goods, objects. I give you telecom. I give you refineries. I give you retail. I give you services, hospitality. I give you all the things that you want. Products and services is what I give. That's why humans create value. And therefore, I feel valuable. I'm an important member of society because I bring goods to society. I'm an important member of society because I bring services to society. If I don't bring goods and services, what is my value? And it is these goods and services that we exchange in the market. And when you look at the market, you see the hunger of humanity for goods and services and a hunger for value. The thing I create makes me valuable. The invention makes the inventor valuable. The poem makes the poet valuable. The music makes the musician valuable. We are making ourselves valuable through goods and services. We exchange value. We also collect value. We gather it around us. I want all the goods in the world. I want all the services in the world. I will collect. We gather achievements. We keep gathering and gathering and gathering because we realize I am what I gather. All the goods in the world, of course, now we use new terms like money, but it is just a change in form. It is goods and services because ultimately, what do I do with the money? I get goods and services, a bigger house, a bigger palace, a bigger car, a private jet. I accumulate and accumulate because my hunger doesn't end like Indra's hunger. I want more and more and more because the world says I am what I gather. And that keeps happening all the time, purushartha. And therefore, the sages came up with the idea that, you know, life is about generating value. That is artha, arthashastra. Arthashastra, artha, one of the pillars of existence is to generate value. The second is kama, consuming value. So artha is about creating value. Kama is about consuming value. One creates goods and services, the other consumes goods and services. We enjoy consuming, and that is fun for us. Partying, what is a party? Party is where I consume services and goods. What is responsibility? When I have to create services and goods. But then they said, you know, there's something more. Whose hunger are we concerned about? And so they came up with the concept of dharma. Are you even concerned about other people's hunger? Yes, your hunger matters, your hunger for value, your hunger for validation, your hunger for goods and services. But what about other people's hunger? Does this matter at all? And therefore, dharma emerges from this idea that other people's hunger matters. But I can only give you things that I value if I outgrow my hunger. And they came up with another concept called moksha, which is outgrowing hunger. Because as long as I am hungry, I will gather value. But the moment I outgrow hunger, whatever value is there, I'll give away. Unless I outgrow hunger, I cannot be charitable. I cannot be generous. Corporate social responsibility will never work as long as I am hungry. Because I will consume. I will not let others consume me. And so validating human life at the first level is about artha and kama. And you see this everywhere. Create generating value and consuming value. That's level one. Every human being does that. Every living organism does that. We create value, we consume value. But level two is what was purushartha in the scriptures. The fourfold path of scriptures, which is dharma, artha, kama, moksha. You anchor it with distributing value and with outgrowing value. So you distribute value and you outgrow value. So dharma, artha, kama, moksha is just about value creation, distribution, and outgrowing our need to be valuable. And why is that important? You see, we all want to witness. We want someone to witness our lives. Yes, we have done this dharma, artha, kama, moksha. But have we really succeeded and given ourselves meaning? We need a witness. Who will tell us that my life is meaningful? Will I tell myself or will someone else tell me? And that is the reason we build our tombs. That is why Indra builds his palaces. He builds his palace not because he has not generated value to consume value or distributed value, outgrown value. He says, who will remember me? Tombs are the same thing as legacy. When I am gone, I shall be remembered. I want to feel valuable even when I die. And therefore, I build these great palaces. Vishwakarma's palaces are never ending. And Vishnu says, but you know, in the denominator of infinity, all that comes will go. That is why you're a living organism. Nothing lasts forever. There are a million Indras out there. Like a tree which comes and goes with time, which sheds its leaf over time, you should shed things with life and allow yourself to be reborn in another form. We are all Indras. We are all building our palaces. But there are infinite Indras out there. There were Indras before us and after us. And like all of them, we will generate value. We will consume value. We will distribute value. But most importantly, we have to figure out how to outgrow our desire to be valuable and allow us to be ordinary. For from dust, we go to dust eventually. And even if we are not remembered, it is fine. You don't remember the mango tree from where you ate the mango. Thank you.